My name is Mara Briere, and I am the founder of Grow a Strong Family, which is a nonprofit that supports families uprooted by mental illness and other brain disorders. I founded Grow a Strong Family 4 years ago as a nonprofit. Before that, I had been an in-home therapist working with families, with loved ones with mental illnesses and behavioral health issues. And when I founded Grow a Strong Family, I did so because I knew that families do not receive support when their loved ones are diagnosed with a mental illness. We have two branches of our organization. One of the branches is a fee-for-service coaching program, which is customized to the needs of each individual family. We've probably helped in the 4 years 70 families. We do a support group for family members. It's called Replanting Lives, and we offer it twice a month, and we have it once in the mornings in Carlisle at the library on the second Tuesday of the month from 10:30 to noon, and we get anywhere from 3 to 8 people. And we do it on the second Wednesday of every month from 7 to 8:30 at the Council on Aging in Bedford, and we get anywhere from 3 to 12 people. So tonight we want to offer the community an opportunity to find out how Grow a Strong Family can help families who have loved ones with mental illnesses or other brain disorders. So we have decided to have an event that would provide free resources and materials, a meet and greet, and then we would have a panel discussion to talk about the issues that often come up that family members sometimes don't even know what they don't even know. And we address issues having to do with safety. And so tonight's panel discussion is with three panelists who are experts in their field or in managing or dealing with loved ones with mental illnesses, because when you consider that 1 in 5 individuals in their lives are likely to know or love someone with a mental illness, it kind of hits everybody. And we're hoping that through this introduction, that people will realize that there is a resource for them, that they can hire a coach to have specialized services to work with their family so that their family can function with their new reality, and also to access all of the free materials that are available so that it's the middle of the night, your loved one is psychotic, you don't know what to do, you have a resource, you can go to it. The other thing we're doing is we're having a opportunity to meet Max the therapy dog. One of the things that Max and I do is we provide therapy services, and we do this at the Council on Aging in Bedford. We also do it at the VA Community Care Program, which is a program for veterans with PTSD and mental illnesses. And Max is also my partner when we work with families. And if anybody ever needs a therapy dog in their lives, we're available. You're not alone. There's help available. Most of it is only a phone call, an email, a text message away. Well, hello and welcome, panelists. And tonight we're going to be having a discussion about what Grow a Strong Family can do for your family who's uprooted by mental illness or other brain disorders. And our purpose is to let you know that we are here, we have lots of ways to support you, and that we have the answers to some of the questions that you might have. And I've assembled this group of experts to basically answer some of the tougher questions that family members have and sometimes don't realize that there are answers, and that we're here and Grow a Strong Family is your resource to start and get some of those answers. So immediately on my right is Laura Baliestero, and she is a board member of Grow a Strong Family. Because we're a nonprofit, we have a board, and our board of directors are all volunteer, and they're fabulous, like Laura. And she's a staunch supporter of our mission to provide services to whomever can benefit from what Grow a Strong Family offers. Laura is an active member in the community as a real estate agent and a successful businesswoman. Next to her is Deb Turner, formerly of Mental Health Association of Greater Lowell, and in her work as a senior management professional and former director of community-based flexible supports, Debbie has dedicated her career to support recovery, maximize independence and self-sufficiency, build skills, promote wellness for individuals whose lives have been affected by serious mental illness. And next to her is...
Drum roll! Amanda Costa, who is the recently promoted Project Director 2 of the Transitions to Adulthood Center for Research at UMass Medical Center of Worcester. She has been promoted to various positions in the past 7-plus years, developing research-informed materials. She oversees daily operations of research studies focused on improving education and employment goals for young adults, 14 to 30 years, with lived experience of mental health conditions. She's responsible for recruiting, screening, selecting, and maintaining study subjects for multiple studies and day-to-day activities for a 17-site national process evaluation for Now is the Time, Healthy Transitions. They have a variety of tip sheets, which we make available through Grow a Strong Family and through their website, which is?
TransitionsACR@umassmed.com.
Thank you. And so, we generated a variety of panel questions, and what we've come to realize is that there are some that are really important for family members to be aware of. And the first one that we thought of to answer, panelists, is when do you know that your loved one is going through more than a phase? And we know that there are signs along the way, and that we know that when the behavior you are witnessing is not in sync with the behaviors of their peers, and there's something off, that we need to find out what that is. However, in my practice and what I provide, I always say, rule out the medical before you go to the psychiatric. Make sure that the blood tests have been taken and that the thyroid is functioning properly, that you have ruled out mono and other illnesses, medical illnesses, physical illnesses, before you ever go to see if it is a psychiatric issue. Panelists, Amanda, Laura, what would you look? We'll start with Amanda. Have any insights you can share?
Yeah, so as someone who's kind of managed my own mental health and someone working with young adults in research, I feel like the hardest thing to say, but the reality of one of these questions is really thinking about going with your gut and navigating your own personal relationships with family members. So thinking a little bit about what you may call red flags or changes in your relationship with someone to indicate that things are going awry. So for me personally, when I was struggling with my own mental health, I was always really big into school. Education was really important to me and really exciting, and I really started struggling with my own academics. So for my family, that was a red flag that something wasn't going right in my life. We weren't sure what it was, but that was one of the first red flags of many. So I think navigating that relationship and what that normally looks like and really paying attention to changes is the first sign for a lot of people. And then that gut feeling that something isn't right, matched with a lot of those red flags, is, I think, a personal way to start noticing that things are going in a way that you may need to get things checked out or be looking at if mental health is involved. And I also think that the personality shift for a lot of people. So for me, what that looked like when I was struggling with my mental health is isolation and kind of avoiding contact with my family and my friends. And it can still look like that if my depression's kicking in. So noticing that I was kind of pulling away from the people I cared about and the people that I was usually close to and had really connected relationships to, I think would be what I'd call another red flag. And so I use that term because I think it felt safe for me when I was going through my own recovery. It was a way for me to identify things that looked different in my life and that were, I was going down a path I didn't want to be on. And so these were some of the indicators that I might be struggling. And again, that's a nice sign, is I had open transparency with my family and with my friends about that, what was going on. So we had a lot of communication. So knowing when someone's going through more than a phase is really talking to them and having that transparent communication to say, I notice things are different, things seem off, here's the things I'm noticing, how are you feeling? And really opening up that connection and communication is one way to figure that out too. Because the person may know or be seeing more in their own life that you're not picking up on, but once you bring it to their attention, it gives them the opportunity to really have that conversation too.
Laura, what's your experience been in exploring when a loved one is going through more than a phase?
Well, I'm the only person on the panel that doesn't have an educational background in mental illness. So for me, it was not even a thinkable situation that my loved one might be dealing with, because I would never consider that my loved one was going through a period of mental illness. In my particular situation, it was my son who was, my husband kept saying he was getting in trouble, boys can be boys, don't take it seriously. He was not being participatory in our family events, isolating, spending a lot of time in his rooms, in his bedroom. But a lot of my friends who have had teenagers at the time, their kids were acting similarly. They weren't, you know, jumping out of bed, getting ready to go to school. They weren't sharing their feelings. They weren't being exactly well-behaved. In my particular situation, my son got involved with the law, which I thought was a little bit bizarre. Things just weren't working out well. And I thought, oh, maybe he's hanging out with the wrong kids, or he was just experimenting with things that he shouldn't be experimenting. And for me, when I realized that we had a real problem was when my friend's kids were moving out of that phase, that phase for us was continuing, that there was longevity in this behavior, that it was becoming a pattern, that we had to be very careful of his reaction and feelings, and that seemed a little bit weird, that he wasn't progressing in the standard way young men progress as they leave high school. So I was slow for the light to come on. I just never imagined that that's what he was dealing with. And I was grateful when I found out what the problem was, because once we had a diagnosis and a reason, we were able to become more proactive in our reaction towards protecting ourselves against the behaviors that were not favorable, and then also encouraging him to deal with the behaviors that he was struggling with too. So diagnosis was really important, but it didn't come quickly.
Do you want to say something?
I do. Having said that, I think this whole question, something that I thought about afterwards, that this whole question implies that families are perhaps struggling with the early stages of diagnosis and way far from treatment, wondering what is this thing. And I think, as we've just heard very eloquently, it's not always quick. The symptoms come and go. They, you know, can be exacerbated by various things. And I just wanted to take a moment to encourage families to, at this point, take stock of yourselves. Are you in good health? Do you have good coping skills? Do you get regular exercise? Do you have a support network? Because it's not the kind of disorder that you and the families and the person with a disability wake up one day and say, oh, I must have major depression. Oh, I must have schizophrenia. It's the last thing on anybody's mind, especially if we're talking about the typical young adults. Certainly other people have symptoms later in life suddenly, but the bulk of it is young adults, you know, when this is emerging. So you're in it as a family member for a while, and recognizing the red flags, the warning signs, whether it's a phase or not, is only going to come with experience. But take care of yourself first to be able to do this job and walk the walk with your loved one. So don't feel guilty early on to make sure that you and your other loved ones are in good shape, because you're going to need it.
The only other thing that I would add about this is trust your gut. You know your child best. You know your loved ones best. If something is off, explore it. You know it. Some of us are more clear about what's going on in our relationships in general, but others of us kind of just flow with them. And if the lack of flow is there, trust that. Explore it. Find out why. And again, have a conversation. I'm concerned about you. The language that you use is important. It's about, I'm concerned about you. This is how I'm feeling, this is what I'm seeing. And even if there's a lot of resistance, you can even use language like, would you humor me? And get a blood test to make sure that you're not anemic or whatever it is first. Oh, again, reiterating, start with the physical. Very often, physical symptoms can be indicative of a more serious illness that needs to be treated, but it's mirroring symptoms of a mental illness. Thyroid problems are particularly notorious for that. The other thing is medications. What medications is somebody taking? Sometimes they can develop symptoms of other illnesses, not only mental illnesses, but other illnesses. For example, lupus is very often brought on by medication, and as soon as you change the medication, the lupus symptoms disappear. So the same thing can be said if your loved ones are taking medications, to look at what some of those side effects are and explore that as well. So have we answered that question pretty thoroughly, you think? Okay. The next question that came up was, how can you obtain help for a person that refuses help and is not in crisis? We will address the issue of crisis, but we're often very concerned about our loved ones way before a crisis has hit. And then we start running into those walls, especially because the onset of most serious mental illnesses occurs in the transition age years, which are between 15 and 30. And if that's the onset, you're also dealing with some of the developmental challenges of that age, which is, I want to be my own person, I want to have my own life, I want to be with my peers, I want to be on the trajectory of developing independence, figuring out what my values are and living by them. And it can appear as though, especially if you're older or a parent, that you're interfering in their developmental prerogatives, when in fact what you're doing is expressing concern for their developmental prerogatives seeming a little off, or maybe a lot off. So when we look at this question, we're looking about it when these individuals are not in crisis. And I'm just going to jump in first and just say, I always do an eye for safety. If I can't get through to someone I care about and I'm worrying about them and they refuse to do anything, I always look around and think about the safety issues. So especially if there's a family history, because the other thing we know about serious mental illness is that there is a genetic component to it. So chances are, if depression runs in the family, then it could be what you're seeing. If bipolar, schizophrenia, schizoaffective, I don't know, there's a whole slew of disorders, and if they run in your family, that would be a good place, once the medical things are ruled out, to be exploring. Because those are nice pointers. I mean, they're not nice pointers, but they're pointers. And almost always, when an individual is diagnosed, there is a sense of relief because it has a name. And this happens, by the way, with physical illnesses too. When somebody has an autoimmune disease, the average length of time for diagnosis is 7 years. So when they finally get a diagnosis, they're like, oh, I'm not crazy. I do have these symptoms. These are medications that I can learn how to manage it. There may be huge lifestyle changes, but this is what it is. This is how you do it. And in essence, mental illness is the same way. There are medications. There are lifestyle changes that need to occur. But the diagnostic piece in the very beginning is where it starts. So, panelists, who would like to jump in first? Go ahead, Laura.
Okay. Well, in my particular situation, I can tell you that nothing I did worked. I was really powerless over getting my son help. He was no longer a minor. I couldn't just put him in my car and bring him to the doctor and make him sit there. I tried many, many things. I tried reasoning with him. I tried bribing him. I tried encouraging him. I tried screaming at him. I tried crying with him. I tried everything. And I can tell you, it finally dawned on me that the reason I could not fix this problem was because it was really a problem that he owned, that it was his problem. and only he could be proactive in his recovery. But what I could do was I could control what I was willing to do with my relationship with him, that I did have some power in my home. So I would say things like, I really wanted him to get a job, but he couldn't get a job because he was not able mentally, he wasn't capable to be responsible, be on time, be efficient, be whatever. And I recognized that, even though for a very long time I thought that would be the solution. But I made a deal. I said, okay, I will pay your car insurance and I will give you gas money, but in exchange, you have to do this. And if you choose not to do that, that's okay. You don't have to do that, but you won't be able to drive the car and you won't be able to have gas money. And I knew that was something that was really important to him. So I got a little leverage from that point. I was able to control what happened in my house. So some of the nutty behavior, I wouldn't tolerate. I would say, you know, if this continues, you have to leave. You can no longer live there. And I did things that I never thought I would do. I threw him out. I forced him to feel the pain of the situation that he was in. It was very counterintuitive for me because he's my firstborn. He's my only son. I adore this kid. And my natural instinct is to protect him. And I could see that this behavior was, you know, going in the wrong direction. So to let him free and to feel that he had no place to live, and no food, and no everything, really started the process of change with him. So my actions, my self-preservation, really helped him get better when he had no other options.
Just one question, just for clarification. When you had to reach this point, was it a matter of safety for you and the family?
I didn't ever fear my safety from him. I never felt that he would hurt any of us physically, but I could see what he was doing to our marriage. I could see what he was doing to his siblings. I could see the negative attention that was sucking out all the good air in our home was happening. My other child could see the fear in our eyes. We became different people. As his behavior got weirder and more bizarre, we became just sort of prisoners in our own home. We were afraid to share with people. Other people, I would never ask anybody, how's your kid doing? Because I didn't want anyone to ask how my kid was doing. So I did all these like little techniques to avoid talking about our children. It was really a painful period.
It's isolating. Yes. Yeah, it is. It's a very painful period. It's very painful for families to realize that you can love somebody to pieces and not rescue them or fix them.
I tried that, and that didn't work either.
And that the effect on the family, we can't sacrifice the whole family for one person who doesn't want us to sacrifice the whole family. It's a layer of guilt on them that could actually be backfire in a way that's very scary and dangerous. Deb, do you have anything you want to add?
I think, and I know this is very difficult because there is still a lot of stigma and hidden secrets about folks with mental illness, so I know what I'm saying is not easy, but I would just, I think the more people you can talk to, network with, extended family members, the person's doctor, again, by the time when you hit 18, you're running into this problem of HIPAA and confidentiality, but if the symptoms start before 18, reaching out to the pediatrician or the GP, if you're involved in a religious practice, the rabbi, the minister, the priest, whoever you can talk to about what are they seeing too. I mean, we are social beings, and I understand that it was shameful, but it shouldn't be. You know, we have all kinds of illnesses. This is just one of them. And to feel like you have to own, as the nuclear family, especially the parents, you have to own knowing this. I'm supposed to know that my child is mentally ill, especially when they're an adolescent. It's just, when you think about it, it's nuts. Nobody can do that. So as I earlier encouraged you to build yourself up and get your armor, if you can then work on your own concepts of shame and get out there and talk to your, if we're talking young adults, talk to their friends' families. Talk to the friends if they'll talk to you. What is everybody seeing? Because in some of these ways, the message might get to your loved one, the patient, rather than from mom or dad, who at this stage of life, as Mara said, really, like, they want to individuate and get away from, much as they might love their parents, it's leave the nest time. So I know what I'm asking is difficult, but the more people you can pull into your network and your loved one's network, the better off you might be. And during these early days of really troubling behavior, depending on what kind of behaviors we're talking about, I would also encourage folks to think about perhaps notifying the local police that you have a loved one who's, you think may be having some kind of medical or mental health issue. You don't know. It's the early stages, but
we'll get to that in the next.
But you know, we talk about crisis.
Don't let your network expand as far as you can, because people are there to help. Whether it's family or colleagues or neighbors, you'd be surprised how many families have been impacted by mental illness and or substance abuse, which is, and or both, in our society.
Well, that brings up another very good point, and that is that very often the mental illness is masked by substance use, and we'll often find dual diagnoses as our loved ones get older, and it's very hard under the current atmosphere to treat the substance use disorder and the mental illness simultaneously, even though that's what the research informs us needs to happen. I also know that it's very important that the substance use needs to stop in order for an appropriate diagnosis to be made and then for the proper medication to be prescribed, if there's medication to be prescribed. The largest group of individuals with dual diagnoses are people with mood disorders, typically bipolar depression, some mania, but not typically mania, but it's the others. And anxiety, that's another very big one that's dual diagnosed. So again, knowing your family history is helpful and knowing what the factors are, but again, we're looking at setting, one of the ways to protect the family and the person you love is to set appropriate limits. If you're a family that has worked hard on recovery from substance use, you probably don't want somebody who's active living in your home. If you're a family that has had an issue or has experienced managing mental health issues, you probably don't want somebody who refuses treatment to have a big impact in the family at the time that they're refusing treatment, because it jeopardizes the wellness of other people in the family. Unless panelists disagree, but this is what I've been found in the research, that you know, it's a very fine line, because currently the law is that our loved ones can only be hospitalized if they are a danger to themselves or others. And half the time, we don't even know. And they're also very good at appearing just fine by the time they get somebody to talk to them about whether or not they're dangerous. So this happens numerous times. They speak to somebody. They say, oh, there's nothing wrong with them. Send them home. They don't even let the families know they're sending them home. They just magically appear or get a phone call. That's another issue for another day. We'll deal with that, too. Amanda, you have some comments?
Yeah, I think I would add that this is a frustrating question for a lot of people, because our answer is you can't force someone to get help if you're not in a crisis that refuses help. But I think for me, one of the biggest things that I push, especially in doing youth mental health research, is to hold out hope and keep communicating. So a lot of our young people, when we interview them and doing research with them, we really partner with young people in our research, so we want to hear from them about their own experiences and how to improve services and supports. And the biggest thing they always tell us is, we're not ready till we're ready. And with young people, they are trying to navigate moving to independence and buying their first car and going to college and doing their own thing and learning to be more independent and away from the family. So arming yourself as a family or just an ally with tools and the knowledge you need when they are ready to communicate is huge, because you don't want them to show up at your door one day ready to talk and you have no idea what you're talking about. And I would say from my own personal experiences too, don't assume someone's not listening because they're not reacting right away. So my mom would always push me and talk to me about things, and I would be like, yeah, yeah, mom, leave me alone. I was hearing her whether or not I wanted to do anything about it just yet. It was resonating, and some part of me was listening and paying attention and being given tools that I could access, being told about NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness, and kind of being peppered with this stuff was important for me. And when I was ready, I then knew I had people who cared. I had people that were still willing to communicate with me, even though I was having a really hard time and being destructive in some ways, and that they knew what they were doing and how to talk to me about it and how to get me tools was important. And then I think for this one, that's big too, is when someone is refusing to get help. I think Deb talked about this a little bit, but arming yourself with a community and arming this person with a community. So as a young person, one of my best experiences was going to a youth advisory council in Massachusetts of all young people in recovery from mental health, because I feel like I learned a lot more from them because I was willing to open up to them more. And I was talking to other young people the way I wouldn't talk to my family about my own experiences and their own experiences. And kind of walking away being like, wow, there's other young people dealing with this, and they have jobs, and they're in college, and they have relationships, and they're living on their own, was really eye-opening for me and helped me to want to get help without feeling like it was someone like a parent or an authority telling me, like, you need to get help. Because as a young person, you do want to be independent. You want to see your life go in that direction. And the shame that comes with having your own diagnosis is huge. So to see other people kind of living it and owning that recovery and really doing well for themselves at your age really, for me, helped me open up a little bit and kind of accept help at that peer-to-peer level. So I really think that's important to think about, that Googled Transitions ACR. You can find a list of resources there with all the links and a little description of everything to kind of find stuff.
And we have materials that are available right now that you can just, after our discussion, you can go and grab. I've taken some of the tip sheets that were developed by Amanda and that I've developed a lot. It's one of the things we do at Grow a Strong Family, is we address the issues that family members need. The NAMI, the National Alliance for the Mental Illness, does have a very good curriculum. It's a nice basic psychoeducational curriculum. It's called Family to Family. It is a 12-week commitment. But it's a nice foundational tool. And then from there, we have a group called Replanting Lives, and it's a support group for families uprooted by mental illness. So even if the individual doesn't identify themselves as having a mental illness, if the family members do, they have a place to go to create that network, to get that support. It's a targeted support group in that we teach skills every week, every month, actually, right now, because we're doing it monthly. We used to do it every week. And we teach skills, and the skills are everything from how to manage symptoms, how to communicate more effectively, how to take care of the family, how to deal with suicide threats, how to take care of yourselves in healthy ways, how to manage the grief, because when Laura spoke about, I didn't want to talk to other people about their children, I have felt that way about some of my family members. And that comes as part of grief, because there is that, I don't want to admit that my child is not doing as well as your child because he or she is not well. And they're not well with, it's not diabetes, it's not cancer, it's not an acceptable not well. Until we decide at some point, like, what the heck, they're doing as well as they can for where they are, and pick and select, and you become very skilled at, oh, she's doing great, or, oh, he's living independently, he's got his own place, whatever that means to you, I can't be responsible for that. So being aware that that those things happen, we have those resources, and they're available on our website. You can download them, you can visit them. We have modules, and they're so named. So when you're not in crisis, there are tools, even if your loved one refuses to get any help. And that also means that they may not join a support group. They may not join a peer group. But that doesn't mean as family members, you don't get the information. Because at some point, up there, whoever is willing, they will come around. and then you're prepared for that, and you can be loving with them. Still set those limits. You still may not want, you know, certain drinking, drugging behavior in your home, but you can have a conversation about it now where you couldn't have a conversation about it before. So the more information you have, the more skills and tools you have in your kits, the better for you. You're still parenting. I work with families all the time, and I say, you know what, we're still parenting our adult children in typical families. Well, this is true in atypical families, and our families are atypical. But we still have to get a blueprint, we still have to figure it out. And it's better to figure it out with people who have the resources that you need for this reality. So, and there aren't many parenting classes on this. We've looked.
If I could just add, I don't know if this helps any, but you know, through the months and years of frustration when your loved one is not embracing the idea of being mentally ill, if it helps, you know, it's pretty healthy that they're not. Mm-hmm. Who among us wants to accept a diagnosis that's life-altering? There's that defense mechanism we used to learn about with Freud, about denial, and so that's, you watch this course of even repeat hospitalizations where, you know, a young adult, and again, this could be an older person, whenever the first breaks are happening, is put on some medication, starts to look pretty good in the hospital, that's it, never meds again, and so you repeat, and it's that cycle of trying and failing eventually, I think, that allows our loved one to say, okay, I'll enter treatment, but I don't know if that helps you hold on to something. They're doing their job. They're denying, you know, especially an 18, 19, 20-year-old. No one these days should ever say, you'll never live a normal life. That's, but again, young adults are not stupid. They're hospitalized on a psych unit. They see what older people, what their stories are like, you know, what the environment's like, and they come out and say, I don't want that. Mm-hmm. So the denial that they're driving you crazy with and making you miserable is actually, I think, a healthy defense mechanism. And I just hope, knowing that, again, you gotta take care of yourself, because you're going to have to go through this a bit before there's some acceptance and some desire to reach out for help. It's just all very normal.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to say that for me, the magic in admitting that there was a problem in my family and that we were struggling with, in our particular case, a dual diagnosis, it was addiction and mental illness, was incredibly liberating, because for many years I felt that I couldn't share the story because it was his story and it wasn't my story. But then when I realized, wait a minute, this is my story too, because I'm the one who's suffering and I'm the one who's having pain from this experience. So I felt like it was okay for me to tell the story from my perspective of it. And I found incredible support. And if I hadn't told the story, I wouldn't have found Grow a Strong Family, which I'm incredibly grateful for. I wouldn't have found my Al-Anon family. I wouldn't have found friends that I could call at any hour and share. And then I was so honest in the struggle that I was having, that people became honest with me, and it was liberating for them. So when I was thinking, oh, their kid's fine, or, you know, this is going great, and then they would tell me, no, they too are going through it. And we became a sisterhood, a familyhood of people who were very, very normal. You know, they were good parents, we didn't do anything wrong. It was just a fact of our life, and I don't feel ashamed. I feel this is my son has a lot of things going for him, and this mental illness or this addiction piece he will struggle with for the rest of his life, but he also will struggle with being a good human being. Not struggle with being a good human being, because he is, and you know, creative and artistic, and it's just one little sliver of the personality. But I'm not ashamed to admit that we're a family that has had mass destruction from mental illness and addiction. And there's a lot of hope, and there's a lot of recovery for parents, and there's a lot of recovery for your loved ones.
I think a big thing when we were prepping for this panel, we kind of all talked about as a group, is that when you finally do kind of open up and talk about your own experiences or the experiences of your loved ones, you find that everyone's kind of like, and it's a really common experience. And the research does tell us 1 in 4 people are diagnosed with a mental health condition during their lives. So to know that of every 4 people in the room, someone is most likely struggling with a mental health condition is important in opening up that you're not alone, the person you're supporting isn't alone, that there's so many people out there kind of figuring out mental health. And that, yes, the stigma often keeps us quiet and we don't talk about mental health the way that we talk about other physical health or chronic illnesses, but we're starting to. And people are learning that it's okay to start talking about it, and it's getting out there more in the media. And so just getting out there and starting to talk and communicate is really huge.
Okay, good. Any last thoughts on this one? When they're not in crisis? The only other thing that I would say is that if you think about relapse in diabetes, heart disease, and other physical illnesses, the relapse rate is 40%. And this is with medication, this is with treatment, this is with doctors overseeing, this is with careful eating and towing the line. The relapse rate is 40%. You know what the relapse rate is for substance use and mental illness? 40%. It's not more. And so one of the things, just like we learn how to manage our end of caretaking, knowing when to set appropriate limits, what those look like, what those feel like, how to protect our relationships, how to partner with our loved ones to the best of our abilities, how to negotiate some of the difficult aspects of loving somebody who has got a chronic illness, and it doesn't matter if it's a mental illness or not, it's a chronic illness, that there are going to be relapses. But the more open we are to those relapses and understand that it's the illness and this is what it looks like, the sooner they can get back to themselves. And not everybody is going to have the life they wanted. They will not all. Not all of our loved ones are going to be working and going to college and living independently in the community. Some are sicker than others. But this is true of any illness. And I think that we need to remember that. And that when we do, all of a sudden we can feel a little bit better about what it is we're experiencing as a family. You ready for the next one, ladies? Now we're looking at a crisis, okay? So the question is, when do you call the police or section a person? How bad is bad? Deb?
Well, I think the obvious, some are obvious. If a person is seriously intending to harm themselves or someone else, or has become assaulted in the home, or serious property damage, I think those need to be addressed immediately. If you have a loved one who hasn't eaten in a week, I would suggest that perhaps they have an evaluation. Any disruption in normal life functionings for any extended period is a serious cause for concern. If your loved one has established a mental health support network already, has a therapist and a psychiatric prescriber perhaps, and has allowed you consent, I would reach out to those people if we aren't talking imminent danger and see if you could put your heads together about what should our next step be. Very often a therapist and or prescriber can make an emergency appointment. Again, this is all if your loved one is willing to go to the appointment and is safe to transport. So I guess I just want to make sure people, it doesn't have to jump from I'm doing okay to they're calling the cops on me necessarily. You got to use, you know, where are you at in this? And if there are people you can call to get, just like we would with a medical, there's all these gradations now of medical care, there's urgent cares and there's walk-ins and it's the ER. You know, so there's more of that for mental health these days. There are crisis services funded by the state in every area of the Commonwealth, and there is an agency funded by the Commonwealth in your area that provides crisis services, and I'm not from Bedford, so I don't know who it is here.
In our area, it's Advocates, and we have on our website under Emergency Services, you will have all the access you need for Advocates. What they do is they would come to your home and they would do an evaluation based on your phone call as to whether or not your loved one is safe to stay at home. And if they're safe to stay at home but need an increase of services, they will put that together. This is to avoid the emergency room. And they have social workers. And if they think that there's danger, they will partner with the police department so that a police officer will come with the social worker. Typically what that looks like is the policeman will stay outside while the social worker goes to the door, and they will ask you, do we need the police here? And they will trust your judgment because you made the phone call. And if the answer is yes, then the police officer will come in and just be kind of a quiet lurking presence. And if not, then not. And if necessary, the policeman would transport the individual to where a bed might be, if that's what needs to happen for the evening. So it's a very good system in that you don't have to worry about going to the hospital or traumatizing your loved one by having a police call. The police might be necessary, but only as a last resort. You want that to be your last resort. What I always tell the families that I work with individually is, because we have a Grow a Strong Family also has a fee-for-service coach program, and what I tell the families that I work with who have loved ones who are not stable and not even seeing a prescriber yet, and there is a concern about violence, that they might want to create a safety booklet. And the safety booklet would include, who do you call in an emergency? And what you start with, a picture of your loved one when they looked great. Because the message you want to communicate is that this is a person who is currently not well. When they're well, this is what they look like. It makes them more a person and not a problem that needs to be solved. And the other thing you do is you say nice things. For example, my daughter really loves artwork. She likes to work with pastels. She likes to read romance novels. She has a great sense of humor. Likes to watch a lot of comedy. Let them know that. She's well-educated. She's very articulate. She's kind of fussy about grammar, and she will correct you. You let them know those. You have those things written down next to the picture. And then you might have a little bit about what the symptoms look like so that they can identify that when your loved one is doing well, this is their functioning. When they're not doing well, this is what it looks like. But these are some strengths that you can tap into for when they're doing, to get them to do better. And you would then also have a list of their medications, if they're on any. If they are substance users, make sure that that is on there as well, because they need to know wherever they go that they typically drink 3 gallons of vodka in 2 days, if that's what it is. I have one client that does that. Because that will have an effect on how they're going to treat your loved one. So it's important information to have a safety plan. And those are some of the basics for a crisis, for an emergency. Who do you need to go to help you manage the emergency? That needs to be documented as well. Do you need to call somebody, a family member, because you have other children at home who may need to be taken care of, or an elderly person at home who needs to be taken care of. We have that a lot also. So you want to make sure that all of that detail is written in this document. You make a copy for the police to have in advance of ever needing them. You may never need them, but if you do, your loved one is real to them as a person. And if you don't, you at least have this safety plan. Anything else you want to add?
Well, I think presenting this information to the police department is vital. I also think, especially in a smaller community, if you know anybody on the police force or you know somebody who does, again, you want to humanize your loved one. Sometimes just a visit from somebody in a uniform, even if it's not a crisis, but I know of a young man who has moved to Lowell, that's where I did most of my work, originally from this community, though. And there's an officer who has stood by him for many years. You know, mom calls him if it's not, like, we need to get him to an ER. And his presence has been very calming, very soothing, and very helpful. So I was joking during our preparation, sometimes it's the mailman who can be helpful. Mm-hmm. But, you know, the thing with the crisis, is, as I'm sure folks know, if you're, if somebody needs to be brought to an emergency room for evaluation for inpatient level of care against their will, if they're not willing, or you don't think it's safe to drive them somewhere, whether it's therapist, psychiatrist, or the ER, that involves a legal document called a Section 12. It's printed on pink paper, so we often refer to it as a pink paper, but because it removes the person's right to refuse that visit. They can be taken against their will for an evaluation. So that it's very well thought out and very careful. And it's, the standard is imminent risk to yourself or others, which for those of us working and for families in the field, sometimes you're ready to pull your hair out because how imminent is the risk? You know your person is not doing well and they're getting worse, but they haven't quite, some professionals will tell you they haven't met that bar yet. But be that as it may, they can be issued, a Section 12 can be issued by a licensed clinician these days. That's a fairly recent change. A doctor of any kind, psychiatrist, medical doctor, or the police. But unless you have one of these tight relationships with a local policeman, again, working in Lowell, a big community, the police, they'll come and make sure everything's safe while the person is being put in the ambulance, but they won't sign the Section 12. They want the mental health system to do that. They don't feel it's that their area of expertise. So it's not a pleasant experience. I don't know if people have lived through this, but for some people, when the police and the ambulance show up at the door, some clients, pardon me, I'm aging myself with language, but what we call our loved ones has changed through the years. Some people just say, okay, I'll go, because it's uniform, and other people, it's been very heartbreakingly messy getting somebody restrained, and I've witnessed that, and I know some other people who are hearing us are here today probably have. So that's the emergency procedure. I mean, the police are there to keep everybody safe.
Just so you know, some police departments in Massachusetts have been trained to handle mental health emergencies. So the language that I always suggest that people use is, if you get to that last ditch and you have to call the police, make sure you let them know it is a mental health emergency. Sometimes they have a police officer who's specially trained. Sometimes they have a social worker they work with. That's not part of these agencies, but is a specialist in, for the police who would come out. But it's constant. We see this all the time. There's no great answer. The mental health system is not as responsive as it could be. One other thing that you said that I think is important to address, and that's the issue of the HIPAA law and what you can and cannot do. One of the things you can do is you can call prescribers, therapists, doctors that your loved ones are working with or getting therapy from, whether or not they have signed a release. You can leave a voicemail, you can email. It's one way. What they cannot do, according to how they interpret the HIPAA law, is call you back and have an ongoing conversation with you. That law is being under, it's undergoing a change, and that will soon change, but it is not yet changed. They're looking to eliminate that. The original goal, for those of you who don't know, of the HIPAA laws was to prevent employers and people who rent homes from finding out information about you. It wasn't intended to block family members from getting full access to care and partnering for your loved one. So they're looking at that and making some changes. Amanda, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Yeah, so I was going to say, I'm less versed with when to call the police or section someone, but I think more so when someone is struggling, that whenever possible to remove the shame of this process. I think it can be scary and overwhelming for everyone involved. And really being transparent and communicating, I think, is really important to me as a person who's worked with young adults and as someone else who's experienced my own mental health condition. So for an example, I worked with a young person who was feeling actively suicidal and didn't feel safe. And so to open the conversation and remove the shame of getting help, I really had an honest conversation and said, I don't feel like you're safe. I don't feel comfortable leaving you alone right now. I think that you need to get more professional help, and I don't think that I can be that person. So what would you like to do? We have some options. We can call the emergency mobile crisis treatment team in our town, or we can call the suicide prevention hotline together. Who do you want to call? And so I kind of gave the power back over to this young person to say, what do you feel comfortable starting? And they wanted to call the suicide prevention hotline, which is run by SAMHSA. And so we called, and I said, I'm going to put the phone on speaker, and I can open the conversation up if you want, and then I want you to start talking. So I said, I'm with my friend. They're feeling actively suicidal. They wanted us to call. You're on speaker. This is my friend. And I named them and said, I'm going to turn over them to talk. And that way they felt safe. I was still there with them. I was supporting them, but they kind of had ownership of their own treatment. In some instances, you're not going to do this. Someone might be struggling to the point where they're not coherent or not able to take ownership of the help they're getting. But I think even in situations where someone's feeling actively suicidal, opening up that line of communication is really important. And I also think the prevention piece. So if someone goes into crisis, they could go into crisis again in the future. If someone's really struggling, they may eventually go into crisis. So preparing them and yourselves for what that could look like and really coming up with a collaborative plan. So for example, there's something out there called the Wellness Recovery Action Plan, or WRAP. I've been trained on WRAP. They have WRAP all over the U.S. and I think even internationally now, but I'm not 100% sure.
Yep, they do. It's been translated in over 80 languages.
There you go. So if you Google WRAP, W-R-A-P, it's a plan that you can actually fill out as someone in recovery with lived experience, or you can fill out collaboratively with someone. And it asks you what you look like when you're doing well, what it looks like when you're struggling, what are your red flags. If you were to have a crisis or weren't safe, what would you prefer the plan to be to get you help and treatment? Where would you like to go? And really kind of sets you up to make the plan and empower yourself on how you want to dictate your own treatment if you are struggling. And when you're not struggling, what you want your wellness plan to look like. And so I think getting those tools and actively engaging someone in these communications is important, because people want to feel empowered to take control of their own recovery. Just like in any treatment with any illness, you want to have a say in what people are giving to you and medications you're taking and how you're being treated.
There's also a family WRAP, which is a plan for the family to put together. And if your loved one has bipolar, Juliet Fast has a wonderful system called Bipolar Happens, and it's cards, and that you fill those cards out with, in a collaborative way. And it doesn't only include, this is my symptom, this is what I'm like when I have this symptom, but it also includes, and this is how you can help. Because the other piece for family members is a feeling of powerlessness, I don't know how to help you. So this is a system that's specifically designed to answer that question. In addition to, this is what I can do to help myself.
Yep.
And then one other thing to be thinking about in terms of crisis, it's always important to think about safety. So think about a safety plan and what that's going to look like. And again, we have many, many, many resources on our website, growstrongfamily.org. Okay? Are we good?
We're good.
You sure now? Okay. And the very last question is, what is one takeaway that you think viewers should have that's important about this topic? Laura.
I think that the one thing that I would like viewers to take away is that you're not alone, that you should not suffer in silence. We have the most incredible resource right in our own town right here, which is Grow a Strong Family, that supports the families of loved ones that are suffering from mental illness. I think you have to get out of the shadow of the shame. You have to unhitch your happiness from whether your loved one is doing well or doing poorly. You have to learn to live, to find your laughter, to learn how to exhale, to take care of yourself. I mean, everybody says, eat well, drink well, rest, exercise. But when you're in a crisis, it's an effort to even breathe. So I would like people to know that you should call growastrongfamily.org and really take advantage of this wonderful resource. And even if things aren't at the crisis stage, get your take care of muscles in shape, because it's secular. So while things are going well, it's the time to get educated. Mm-hmm. It's a time to make connections. It's time to get people who you trust and to feel there's so many resources that you don't even know about. But growastrongfamily.org can really get you on the road to your recovery. And that's really what's... Thank you. Deb?
Stole my thunder here. I think she's pretty much said it all. Again, I just... there's nothing about mental illness that's anybody's fault. We don't know to this day what causes it. Therefore, we really don't know how to fix it. We're prescribing all these medicines that target neurotransmitters, and they may help with the symptoms. Some, as folks know, come with a litany of side effects, some potentially pretty uncomfortable, some that people don't want to talk about because they're private, but this is not an easy road. And it's not an easy road mostly. I mean, my years of experience have been trying to help the person with the mental illness. I'm very appreciative for family support and welcome it, but these are real people. When I left college and took my first job in mental health, the biggest pleasant surprise was people were not symptomatic all the time, and it's like, my goodness, these are real people. If they were smart before they became mentally ill, they're still smart. If they weren't too smart, they're not going to get any smarter. But people did things like, I told the girls the other night, I once treated myself to a nice wooden desk chair from my office, and it arrived in a box. And so I just sat on the box for a few weeks because that was beyond me, until one day I asked one of my male clients, Tom, any chance you could put this together? And I sat in that chair for 20 years afterwards. I mean, people want to help. They have skills. If they had good senses of humor before, chances are it might be a little bit different now. You might have to, and it's not going to be ever present. But, so my focus is not on families. But I think I want people not to be ashamed, to realize people can live quality lives. Mm-hmm. And the best way, I think, to try and maintain your family connections is, as we've heard people say, is to be as open and honest. You can't, especially as parents, you're geared to take care of, to fix. By the time 18 hits, you're done. Your job is done. You want to become a partner and an ally in this person's, the journey that they're on. You think yours is tough. Theirs is tougher. So partner with them. And when they won't take your help, take care of you, but just be available when they will. This is, I guess, all I can say.
Very well said.
I would reiterate what everyone else said. But also, I think a big thing for me is that we all have to manage our mental health. And I think we talk about mental health only when someone has a diagnosis and they have a mental illness. And that's when mental health comes into play. But whoever you are in this world, mental health and managing your health and well-being is a full-time job on top of everything we're already doing. And so we all need to be thinking about mental health and wellness and removing the shame from being well. And I know that's hard to do in a society where we stigmatize mental health and struggling and not sleeping and working all the time, and really things that can be detrimental to your mental health are areas of pride for a lot of people, especially in our culture. And so really thinking about the boundaries of mental health and how do we do that for ourselves and also the people we love. And that mental health doesn't discriminate. I think that's a huge thing, is that we all, and myself included, before I got diagnosed with my own mental health conditions, made a lot of assumptions about what mental health looks like and who is mentally ill versus who is not. And there's no discrimination by socioeconomic status or race or ethnicity or gender, that people all over the world and all different walks of life are struggling with mental health, and we have to really think about how we're treating mental health in our communities, and that there's no shame in getting help and reaching out, because there's so many people out there who are trying to recover and manage their own mental health. I can't remember the woman's name who wrote the article where she said, "No, when my family member was struggling with mental illness, no one brought me casseroles." Just like when people are struggling with physical health conditions, people bring casseroles and food and want to help. And it was kind of like the "where's my casserole?" And so a lot of people call mental illness the casserole illness. And it's that joke on when you do have someone in your life struggling, or when you're struggling with your mental health, it's this secretive thing that it's behind closed doors and no one's there trying to help you recover. So I think the biggest takeaway for me is we need to stop doing that. And as a community, we can all come together and empower each other to really balance what wellness can look like, and to bring those flipping casseroles to people who are struggling, because they shouldn't feel shame in getting help, and treatment is possible and it's available And I'm living, breathing person, living with mental health myself and managing school and work full time and in a grad program and in a relationship and living on my own. And I really didn't know if that was possible for myself when I got diagnosed and really struggled. And so like the reality of getting treatment and taking care of yourself and that it takes a village, but we have villages here, so we should all tap into them when we can.
And just to speak to those who have more serious mental illness and may not be able to achieve those goals, there's still the right to have a good quality life, whatever that's going to look like. Mm-hmm. And it may need more structure, more supervision. It may look different than intended, but I think we have an obligation to offer that if we can as a society, and I think it's something worth striving for. And it's the biggest frustration in my experience that parents have when their loved ones have serious mental illness and they don't know what they don't know. They don't know what the recovery might look like for them. It might just be living in a room where somebody comes and provides meals, but they can be on the internet and do some research and take online classes, and that's what they perceive as the best quality of life for themselves. It's not about what we think is the best quality of life for that person. And so the final comment that I'll make is the three C's, and that's we didn't cause it, we can't control it, and we can't cure it. And that's the bottom line with every chronic illness, but certainly and especially with mental illness. So we hope that you found this panel interesting and enlightening, and if you have any questions at any time, feel free to write a comment, get in touch with us at growastrongfamily.org. You will get a response. Thank you.
Thank you. That's good.